בשם השם נעשה ונצליח, שיעור תורה, פרשת שלח. A lot of things happening in this parasha. This is actually, you know, now that we're back to Sefer Bamidbar, the book Numbers, book of Numbers. I don't know why the American translation translated Bamidbar, which means the desert, to Numbers, which is Numbers. But anyway, that's what it's known for. A lot of things happening in this book. The storyline continues. There's less laws and more of a storyline of what happened to Am Yisrael in the desert during the 40 years of the desert. This is still early on of what's happened. And in this particular parasha, we have several different major events that took place. One of them is one of the worst events in Jewish history. And obviously something we're going to learn about in a moment, momentarily, which is when Am Yisrael sent the spies, the meraglim, to the land of Israel to see what the land looked like, how it was, who lived there, and so on. And those meraglim, with the exception of two, brought back a very bad, or as the Torah calls it, evil report. because Am Yisrael started crying after they heard this report, because they believed these people, instead of believing what Hashem said that since you cried for nothing, I'll give you a reason to cry. And from that day on, that became Tisha B'Av. And all the major disasters that have happened throughout history to Am Yisrael have happened on that day. Tisha B'Av, if you guys remember, the first Bet HaMikdash was destroyed on Tisha B'Av. The second Bet HaMikdash was destroyed on Tisha B'Av. You know, the difference between the two, the first Bet HaMikdash was around for 410 years. It was a 70-year difference. Then the second one was around for 420 years. So you're talking about a span of 900 years. The Bet HaMikdash, in essence, was in our life. Yet the destruction happened on the same day. The chances of that happening obviously cannot be random. Like some people like to believe that things in the world are random. And many other disasters throughout history have happened on Tisha B'Av. The reason, one of the reasons that Chazal explains to us that Hashem chose this day is because since Hashem does not like to bring bad news to Am Yisrael, does not like to bring punishment to Am Yisrael, He did not bring us to this world to suffer, He did not bring us to this world to get punished. But nonetheless, when we have when we take actions that are against Hashem, as we'll learn from this parasha, we'll get punished for it. And there's no way around it. Someone does something bad without doing tshuva, we'll get punished for it. So to limit the overall national punishment, there's obviously individual punishment and there's national punishment, Hashem tries to put it and consolidate it, if you will, to one day throughout history, which is Tisha B'Av, that has happened to be one of the major days that we had many of our disasters happen.
This is also the day the spying says what it
thinks. This is the day that the spies came back with their bad report. So it literally says it in the parasha where Hashem says that they, since they cried for nothing, He will give them a reason to cry. And many other bad things have happened on this Tisha B'Av. So this is one thing. Well, first off, we would like to thank Daniel and Nicole for hosting us, Baruch Hashem. May this shiur go to their Kedushat HaBayit. This should be Chanukat HaBayit. May Hashem bring them a lot of blessing in this house, for the family, with a lot of Torah, children, Parnasah, Rosh Hashanah, and all the good that's in the world, Baruch Hashem.
Amen.
So, moving on into this parasha, we start off, Vayedaber Adonai Moshe le'emor, Shelach lecha anashim, Vayaturo et Eretz Kanan, Asher ani noten levnei Yisrael, ish echad lemate avotav, Tishlachu kol nasi bahem. So Hashem says to Moses, saying, send forth men, if you please, and let them spy out the land of Canaan. Canaan was the name of Israel before it became Israel, that I give to the children of Israel. One man each from his father's tribe shall you send, every one a leader among them. So Hashem is telling Moshe to send a leader from each one of the 12 tribes to go scout out the land and see what it's all about. So now these 12 people were the best of the best. These weren't 12 regular people. This weren't like 12 soldiers that were just common people. This is like 12 giant rabbis, or even more than rabbis, going to scout the land. So the first question that people ask is, why do they even need to scout the land? What, Hashem's word's not good for it already? He already told us it's going to be a land of milk and honey. He already told us it's going to be a great land. What do we need to do this for? The second question is, why did Moshe go along with this? Why did he go along? Why did he tell the nation, listen, I'm going to choose 12 people to go and scout the nation, scout the land? So the answer to both of them is one and the same. The people had a lack of emunah, and even though Hashem told them that it's going to be a land of milk and honey, they still wanted to see. Still wanted to see for themselves. Sometimes you have a child that asks for something ridiculous. And he keeps asking and asking and asking and asking. And you know he doesn't really want it. He just wants to annoy you, or he just wants to your attention or something. And the parents sometimes will say, you know what? You ask it, now I'm going to give you extra even. And you know that he wasn't really, you know, asking for it because he wanted it. So you say, you know what? I'm going to give you even extra. Why? Because you're going to do it to try to, you know, to show him that he doesn't really want it. And you know that he's going to say, no, you know what? Okay, now that you want to give it to me, I don't really want it. I was just kidding. And that was, in essence, what Moshe Rabbeinu was doing over here. We were saying that there's no way that they really want to see the land. Hashem's promise should be good enough. So if I tell them, yeah, go ahead, you can go to Eretz Yisrael, you go to Canaan and check out the land, once they know that they're allowed to go, then they're not going to really want to go anymore. Unfortunately, he was disappointed. The emunah of some of the people in Israel was lower than he expected, so when he said, yes, you can go, they said, oh, okay, great, we're going to go. So it worked actually against him. But either way, he still chose the best of the best, a leader of each one of the tribes. This is more than a rabbi in the sense that each one of them was not just a leader of 100 people or 500 people. But each one of them was a leader of tens of thousands of people. If you remember the census that they took in the parasha a couple of weeks ago, they counted all the people. These were the leaders, each one of them. This wasn't the specific leaders that were mentioned in a couple of weeks ago, but these were leaders amongst them. So each one of them was a leader of a few thousand people. So they had to be special. Now there's two other people that within these 12 that were picked. One of them was Caleb, son of Jephunneh. And the other one was Yeshua ben Nun. Now, Yeshua, in this parasha, it says, originally his name is Hosea, son of Nun. But it says that Moses called Hosea, son of Nun, Joshua. Moses added a yud, added a letter to the name of Joshua, because a yud is one of the letters that's in Shem Hashem. So this is actually one of the symbols that Chazal explains to us, that he was praying for him. Because Moses had a feeling, being a prophet, you tend to get these feelings, that the report was not going to come out very good, and he didn't want Joshua to get influence in a negative way from the rest of the people. Because he knew that Joshua had very good midot. Mm-hmm. Joshua had very good midot, he was very special, and he eventually will become the leader after Moshe. He's going to actually be the one that brings Am Yisrael into Israel. So he didn't want him to get tainted with anything negative. So he added a yud, which was a symbol, a symbolism of him praying for him. This, if you remember, changing of name happened a couple of times in the Torah. For example, Avraham Avinu. Originally his name was Avram. Hashem added a hey to his name. Sarah Imenu, his wife. Hashem changed her name to Sarah. Yaakov was later called Israel, and so on. There's several times in the Torah that a name is changed, and generally it's to add more kedusha into the name. Today's world, people change their names on a regular basis because it became somewhat of a zgula, I guess, in recent generations, or it actually has been around for a long time. But people, I think, of taking it a little too far, not just in my opinion, other people are saying it, where they're just changing their names constantly. If their name is Daniel, they call themselves, I don't know, Yoram, or they call themselves Chaim, and for no reason, just because they had bad luck. Obviously, sometimes you see people where their names is Chaim. Usually people that their name is, if they have a second name that's Chaim, it's usually because they went through a major life crisis where they almost died, either through a disease or accident or something like that. So that's why you'll see a lot of Jewish people that have a second name, Chaim. That's usually the reason. But as far as names are very, very important. It's good to know. The Gemara says that when your parents are at a decision time of naming the child, there's a 1/60th of a prophecy that comes to them to give them your name. Meaning that your name that you have is not a random thing. It's not something random. It's not that just something that just people just picked out. There's a reason why your first name, not your last name. In Judaism, in reality, just so you guys know, in Judaism, it's all about your first name, not your last name. In the Torah, no one has a last name. In the Gemara, no one has a last name. No one has a middle name. Okay, so it's like, Yaron ben David, and so on and so on. It's whoever your father is, that's your last name. But it's not. There's no such thing as Yaron Reuven in the Torah. Or Moshe Smith. There's no such thing. It's just the first name. So that's so people are, in today's age, people also like to call their children with a couple of names, especially in America. They like to give their kids the first name and second name, and they also have a last name. I'm not really sure if that's because we adapted to the times. Religious people, I don't know. I've never seen one, but that doesn't necessarily mean that I'm right. But maybe in America, I'm not really sure. I'm not really really sure. Yeah, well, either way, the point is, as far as names, it's good to know that your name is part of a prophecy. Now, of course, there's always an exception to every rule. Some people don't listen to it. Some people that are completely disconnected from Torah, completely disconnected from God, completely disconnected from anything relating to spirituality, and they come up with silly names for their kids. Like, there's a couple in Israel that reported maybe about a year and a half ago, they called their son Like. Like the button Like on Facebook? They call their son Like. And there's many other silly names. I think
like a Northwest.
There. Yeah, I think somebody, some celebrity called their son a name after some fashion company, Northwest, something like that. Yeah, there's a lot of silly things that people do. We try not to do that. We try to call our children based on what it says in the Torah. But again, name is not, it is a big deal. It's not just something random. So Moshe Rabbeinu added a yud to Yeshua ben Nun's name, and the whole aspect of the whole story of sending the people of the leaders of Israel to Canaan is something that's not exactly that Hashem doesn't exactly like too much. He's considering it as Israel, Am Yisrael, is testing him. And as you guys all know, we are not allowed to test God for anything except one thing. Meaning you can't say, God, if you give me a sign, I'll keep Shabbat. God, if you give me money, I will do this. God, if you give me a I don't know, a wife or a girlfriend or a job or anything, I will do this. You're not allowed to do it. It's kfirah 100%. You're not allowed to do it in any way. You're not allowed to test Hashem. Hashem is not your friend. Hashem is not your buddy. Hashem is not anything relating to that. He's not human. So imagine yourself in front of a mortal king, le'avdi from Hashem, obviously, but imagine yourself in front of a king. A king says, listen, you have to do A, B, C. You have to do 10 things for me every day. And you say, okay, well, I'll do them, but first you have to give me something. If you think about it for more than 5 seconds, you realize that by saying something like that, you're very likely to get your head chopped off from that king. So the avdil from this king to the king of all kings. So with Hashem, you're not allowed to test them. There's only one thing that Hashem specifically tells us that we're allowed to test them, which is called maaseh. Maaseh is giving 10% of your net income. You have an income that you generate if you work or any other way. And out of that income, there's expenses. After you pay your expenses, there's something that's left. Whatever is left, so let's say, for example, you make $5,000 a month and you have expenses of $3,000, so you have $2,000 a month left. Out of the $2,000, you're supposed to give 10% of that $2,000, so that's $200, to tzedakah. The most highly recommended tzedakah that the Gedolei Adol throughout generations have always recommended has been either to people that study Torah full-time or to do KIRUV, to save lives. Not just lives in this world, but life in Olam Haba. Those are the two things that are the most worthwhile tzedakah causes, because they're the ones that generate the most amount of mitzvot. If, for example, you give $200 to Bet Knesset, and let's say they put, I don't know, they buy a new lamp, great, it's a new lamp. Let's say it's considered a mitzvah, which I'm not really sure if it is considered a mitzvah or not, that it's lit more than once, but let's say it is. Let's say you get a mitzvah every time the light bulb is lit. Okay, so you get it 7 times a week, it's lit, you get 7 mitzvot a week, 365 days a year, or probably less because there's Shabbat. Let's say you get 300 mitzvot a year on this light bulb that you bought. With a Talmid Chacham, someone that's learning Torah, this person that's learning Torah, every single letter of Torah that he reads is a mitzvah. Every letter, not every word, every letter. And a real Talmid Chacham, they calculated, can do something close to about 600,000 mitzvot per day. As far as just from his reading Torah. If he studies for 60,000 mitzvot per hour, 10 hours a day of reading Torah, that's 600,000 mitzvot in a day. So the amount of mitzvot that you will get through, several generations through this light bulb, assuming it lasts that long, will never equal to just one day worth of mitzvot from a Talmid Chacham. The same concept goes to Kiruv. If you get one of these discs, Rabbi Mizrahi, or any of the other number of rabbis that are doing Kiruv, and they help somebody do tshuva, each mitzvah that person does, at that point goes into your account also. Every time they keep Shabbat, every time they read Torah, every time they do tefillin, every single time their children, and their children, every one of their mitzvot goes into your account. So it's an endless amount of mitzvot that goes into your account. Even a Sefer Torah, which Baruch Hashem were able to donate when times were good financially, maybe close to 10 years ago. Even a Sefer Torah will not yield you as much mitzvot as helping one Jew do tshuva. Because a Sefer Torah, at most, is going to be used 3 times a week. In reality, it's going to be more like 3 times a month, if that much. Because most Bikneset, there's more Bikneset than there is than we really need. And each Bet Knesset has more than enough Sifrei Torah. There's very rarely do you find a Bet Knesset that has a shortage of Sifrei Torah. So each Bet Knesset has 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. They can't read 10. They read one at a time. So you have twice during the week, once on Shabbat. So you have 3 times a week. So even if your Sefer happens to be the only one, so maximum, you have 3 times a week. It's 156 times a year. That's pretty much it. So, and they rotate, exactly. Sometimes there's places actually in Brooklyn where they have over 100, 150 Sifrei Torah. And in reality, if your Sefer is used once a year, you're lucky. If it's used once a year, you're lucky. So again, it's a very big mitzvah in the sense that you're money-wise, you're donating $30,000, $40,000, $50,000, $100,000 for Sefer Torah. But with $100,000, you know how many lives you can save? So it's just something to know that, again, it's using our money wisely and being businessmen with our mitzvot also. So now, moving on into this Maaser, Hashem tells us that Maaser v'titasher, we're allowed to test Hashem, where if someone that gives Maaser, is Hashem is promising them to become rich. Now he's not saying that you're going to become rich instantly, but he says that you will become rich at some point in your life if you continuously give 10% of your income. There's countless stories of how this works. This is amazing. It's 100% foolproof. It works. The only thing that's a variable is when. Some people it happens very quickly. Some people a little slower, but it works nonetheless. Unfortunately, for the people that it doesn't work for, it's because they gave up somewhere along the way. They tried it for 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years. They didn't become rich. They said, I'd rather just keep the 10%, and then they end up losing even what they have. So it's not a really good idea to do it. As far as to give up, to give 10% of our income is not really a big deal. It's something that anyone that knows the significance of the mitzvah should definitely do it. And it becomes more difficult when we become rich, not when we're average. Someone makes $5,000, $10,000, $15,000 a month. Okay, so giving $1,000 a month is not exactly, making anyone cry at night that they're missing this $1,000. But once you're making $300,000, $400,000, $500,000 a month, because you became rich, the key is to keep giving that 10%, keep giving that $50,000, $100,000 a month. Because Hashem only gave you that money so you can give it, not so you keep it. He doesn't care about your Bank of America account. Okay, now we move on to something very, very interesting. There's a lot of people that have a tough time with certain parts of the Torah that they didn't read. Now, usually anything that I didn't read, I have a problem with. Why? Because I don't know what it says. The problem with Judaism is that people usually tend to have a problem with something that they didn't read, but they still feel they should be able and entitled to judge it. So this is like me going to a doctor's office or a lawyer's office, and I'm not a doctor, nor am I a lawyer, and tell them, listen, everything that you're doing is wrong. What's the doctor going to tell me? Slap me around. Get out of my office. What are you talking about? Lawyer, same thing. Probably call cops and arrest me. Thinks I'm, something wrong with me. But in Judaism, it works. And no one ever says anything about it. People that have never read even the Chumash, forget about being Talmidim Chachamim, forget about being sages, or even just a average, regular person that knows a little bit of Torah. Talking about people that have never read the Chumash from beginning to end with a basic level of understanding, spent 20 minutes of their life remembering maybe two or three verses, and they feel like they can judge the religion as a whole. They feel like they can tell rabbis who's wrong and who's right. And I see this all the time, especially on the internet. We have a group on Facebook, which Baruch Hashem has grown to over 1,500 people now. It's called Torah to Help Our Lives. And we post different Shiurei Torah from different rabbis, whether it's my own or Rabbi Mizrahi, Avdil for me and him. Obviously, they're much bigger rabbis than anything I could do. But the point is Rabbi Mizrahi, Rabbi Zamir Cohen, Rabbi Amnon Yitzchak. There's a few big rabbis. I watch their lectures. Anything that I watch that's good, I post it. But now we've actually also had some big rabbis join our group. They're posting themselves also. So we had Rabbi Alon Anava. He had a very big story. He had a near-death experience. Near-death experience. He died and came back to life. And he did Teshuva after he came back to life after he saw what the real world. He got the schut to see what happens when you die. And it's a very, very interesting interesting story. I'd recommend everyone to watch it. He has a few lectures. And if you see him now versus what he looked like before he did tshuva, very hard to recognize the two people. It's unbelievable what tshuva and Torah does to somebody. So he actually joined the group. There's also another rabbi that joined just a couple of days ago, a very big rabbi, Rabbi Skobek. He's a counter-missionary. He works against those groups in Christianity, Catholicism, especially Christianity, that pretty much their mission is to convert Jews to Christianity. Their mission is to chase Jews around the world. Mm-hmm. And convince them to convert to Christianity. So this is the stories that we heard in the past, where you know you either convert or die. In today's world, it's not either convert or die. In today's world, it's either convert and we'll give you a bunch of money, or convert and we'll give you a bunch of money. Like pretty much they entice poor people that have money problems with money, with hundreds of millions of dollars. Just in Israel, they did a statistic recently, just in Israel, the small, tiny little country of Israel, the missionaries spend over $300 million a year. $300 million a year trying to convert Israelis and other Jews that live in Israel to Christianity. So he's one of the rabbis that works against these groups by proving that their whole New Testament is completely fake and nonsense, and there's countless mistakes in it. As a matter of fact, this particular parasha mentioned something about it. There's a in verse 22, in the beginning of 13:22, it says, "Ve'alu b'negev ve'avo ad Chevron, v'sham achiman sheshet v'talmei yedei." Okay, so here it's mentioning something, Chevron. Chevron is, so it's telling us that Caleb went to Chevron, Hebron, or Hebron in English, and over there, he ran into the giants, or everyone saw the giants. We'll talk about the giants momentarily, but the point is that it mentions Chevron. Why did he even go to Chevron? Why, I mean, Israel is not exactly a big country, but why did he pick Chevron out of all countries, out of all cities? Because Chevron is where the cave of Machpelah is. Chevron is where the cave where the patriarchs Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov are buried, and also the first Adam HaRishon is also buried there, and Sarai Menu is there. You know, the matriarchs are buried there. This is a very, very important cave. The reason why I actually wrote, put a note here as proof New Testament has mistake. On my notes here is because in the New Testament, the Brit HaChadasha in Hebrew, they have, instead of Chevron, which is a known throughout the entire Tanakh, it's known that in Chevron is where the Mara Mechpelah is. The cave of Mechpelah is in Chevron. And if you go there, you will see Mara Mechpelah is in Chevron. Everyone knows where Chevron is. In the New Testament, they wrote it's in Nablus.
Shechem.
It's completely somewhere else. Completely different city. So the funny thing is that they're saying that their book is real, but yet how is it that you have a wrong location in your book? How could, what, God forgot where he put it in the first book? This is actually was one of the proofs that Rabbi Mizrahi put in the debate versus the Christian professor that showed him this is one of the questions that Christianity cannot help, answer. There's 800 questions, if I'm not mistaken, 800 or 900 questions that the Rambam came up with on the New Testament when he had a debate in the palace against the top of Christianity in front of the king. And he brought up these 800 or 900 questions that until this day they cannot answer. And because answering any one of those questions would mean that their religion is fake. So this is very interesting. One of them is, again, how is it that in the first book, if the New Testament agrees with the Old Testament, meaning if it's a continuation of the Old Testament, then that means that it has to agree with it. It cannot contradict it. So how could it be in the first book in the Old Testament, in the Torah, it says Chevron, but in the New Testament it says Nablus? It's two different places. Mm-hmm. Same thing goes with another thing. Like, for example, it says specifically in a couple of places in the Torah that Yaakov Avinu came down to Egypt with 70 people. In the New Testament, it says 75. Where's the extra 5 people come from? And there's countless mistakes. If you look at it, there's literally, if you know the Torah and you know the New Testament, you could literally find a mistake in every single page. So,
they claim the New Testament is divine?
Yes, of course they claim it's divine.
Somebody wrote it.
Tell them that. Explain that to them. Explain that to 2 billion people.
Well, who got it then? If it's divine, who was given it?
No. They believe that it was like the equivalent of Ruach HaKodesh, which is the equivalent of how we got our, like Psalms and all of the prophets and stuff like that. So it's a long story. I mean, it doesn't really have much to do with the parasha, but the key with Christianity is that it's a the religion. To try to sum it up in a simple way, the religion follows a figure where everyone that wrote the book, it started with by a guy named Paul. Everyone who was actually a Jew, is the real name was Saul. Anyway, the religion started between 70 to 300 years after JC died, after their deity, after their God or their Messiah, the guy that they're pretty much writing about, that he said all of these things. After he died, 70 to 300 years after he died, they wrote it. So you're thinking to yourself, what's the big deal? What's the big deal that they wrote 70 years to 300 years later? This means, and it's their own testament, it's not me saying it, it's fact. None of the people that wrote the book ever knew him. So it's not even secondhand information. There's no proof that he said anything that he said. So that's just one of the ridiculous things or absurd things about it. So you're asking yourself, okay, but what about the Torah? The Torah was written 3,300 years ago, a little over 3,300 years ago. First of all, the Torah was given to us in front of millions of people. Mount Sinai was an event that the entire world enjoyed. Not just Am Yisrael, everyone knew that Mount Sinai was happening. Even people at completely different ends of the world knew that Mount Sinai was happening. It was something that the world has never seen and will never see until the Mashiach comes. Nothing like this ever happened or will happen again. And the Torah was given in front of millions and millions and millions of people. New Testament was not given. It was one guy. And then he spread out the religion. That's one thing. The story inside the New Testament is based on some woman's dream that she had and so on. It's based on one person with no evidence and no witnesses. Second thing is, the people that are being written about, the people in the story, in the Torah, they're the ones that got the Torah. Meaning that, let's say for example, there's a new Torah that's going to be written, or a story that's going to be written right now, about us, given to us. So we're in the story. So if I tell you, listen, I'm writing a story about us, and I know that Meir was sitting on my right, and Tomer was sitting on my left, and then all of a sudden I say, you know what, and Shalom was sitting in the middle. Shalom's going to say, no, I wasn't sitting in the middle. I was sitting on your right. Oh, there's a mistake here. So it's not a divine book. So in Judaism, all of the people that were in the story got the book, which means that if there was even one mistake, like for example, when they said that Am Yisrael heard Hashem speak and also saw His words. So if anyone out of the millions of people didn't hear Hashem, someone in the back didn't hear Hashem, said, no, Moshe, no, I didn't hear Hashem speak. You wrote in the book that I heard Hashem speak. I don't remember hearing Him speak. And also, you wrote over here that a few weeks ago that you split the ocean. I don't remember that. If that happened, then someone would have said, listen, I don't remember this happening. The whole Torah goes to the garbage. But that's what it is. But the fact that all of the people that are in the story are the witnesses to the story shows the divinity of the Torah. Whereas in the story of the New Testament, the people that are in the book are not even alive anymore. And even the people that you're writing the story about, like for example, Mary, the woman in there, there's no witnesses to her talking to God or having intercourse with God or some other nonsense that they wrote. So that's, again, something to think about, where, especially people that are watching this online. if you believe in such things, you have to really put a little bit of weight into these thoughts. I mean, if Hashem gave us, you're saying that the New Testament is a continuation of the Old Testament. It's a continuation of the Torah. So if Hashem really gave a second Torah, he really gave the New Testament, why wouldn't he make such a big event like Mount Sinai again? If the first Torah was really special, it should mean that the second one, the New Testament, if it's divine, should be even more special. Or at least just as special. So why did he only give it to one guy? Same thing with the Quran. Same thing with the Muslims. This guy Muhammad was in a desert. He doesn't know how to read. He doesn't know how to write. This is their own words, not mine. He does not know how to read. He's illiterate. Does not know how to read. Does not know how to write. But he comes up, back from the desert, and he tells somebody that I saw the angel Gabriel, and he told me this, and you need to write it for me because I don't know how to read and I don't know how to write. And he tells him this is the continuation of the Torah of the Yehudim, of the Jews. The Torah of the Jews, this is the continuation. There's no witnesses to what he's saying. So it's really important for us that when we're asking questions, we really need to know, is this information legit in the sense that there is multiple sources that are proving this, or is it just this guy's opinion? If it's somebody's opinion, I have no interest. If it's Hashem's opinion, then I like it. Why? Because Hashem's opinion has witnesses. Hashem's opinion had millions and millions of witnesses. So now, one of the things that people have a tough time with is the mystical part of the Torah. So people that do not know Torah. I'm not talking about people that are Talmidim Chachamim. I'm talking about people that are still new to the religion or completely have no religion in it. They have a very difficult time believing certain parts of the story. So for example, we're actually talking about Baruch Hashem on Shabbat, and we realized that if we use our own logic, we cannot even get through Parashat Bereshit. We cannot even get through the first week of existence in the Torah and believe it. Our logic and Torah cannot go together. Why? If you use our own logic, then our logic is based on what we know, on what we see. I see that there's a wall, there's people, there's a sky, there's different things. I see regular things. I see that people are average size, big people are maybe 7 feet tall. So when the Torah mentions to me there are giants that will reach the sky, and this guy was 20 feet tall, and there was strange animals and all of these things, it's hard for me to believe based on my own logic. But then when someone says, I believe in the Torah, then that makes it everything easier. Because that person that says, I believe in the Torah, is also telling me that when he reads Torah, when we're talking about Torah, he's removing his own logic. He's removing anything that makes or doesn't make sense to him. And whatever it says, he believes. So now, we're not talking about the secrets of the Torah. That we'll get to eventually, Be'ezrat Hashem. We're talking about the basic, literal meaning of Torah. So now in this parasha, we sent these spies to Canaan, and they came back with a report. And this is what they said. Well, this is actually what they experienced first. Ve'alu b'negev ve'avo ad chevron v'sham achiman sheshai v'talmai yelidei ha'anak v'chevron sheva shanin nivneta lifnei tzoran mitzrayim. So it's saying, they ascended and spied out the land from the wilderness of Zin. They came from the desert to spy out the land to the expanse at the approach of Hamat. They ascended in the south. So this is just telling you the direction they took. And he arrived at Hebron, where there was Aminah, Ahiman, Sheshai, and Talmai. So these three people. The offspring of the giant. Anak. Anak, everyone knows what Anak means. Anak means giant. Hold on, we don't know what Anak. Anak to us is someone that's 10 feet tall. When I told you guys, listen, Ma says Moshe was 15 feet tall. It's hard for you guys to understand. It's hard for you to believe it. What do you mean Moshe is 15 feet tall? What is he, a giant? What is this? What is that? 15 feet tall. You mean 15 feet? Like, really 15 feet? Or... 15 feet. He's 15 feet tall. He's 10 amot. Moshe Rabbeinu, according to Gemara, was 10 amot. 10 amot is about 15 to 20 feet. So it's not necessarily 15 feet. It could be 20 feet, depending on how long a ma is. So he's 10 amot. His stick was 10 amot. And he jumped in the air 10 amot to reach the ankle of Og, Melech HaBashan. Og, the king of Bashan. He only reached his ankle after he jumped 10 amot in the air, and he had a stick that was another 10 amot. So in essence, he was 30 feet in the air. Oh no, 45 feet in the air. And he only reached the ankle of Og. So when I told you this story, this is in the Gemara, Gemara the Foreshet. It's hard to understand. Why? Because we're using our logic. We never saw somebody that big. Right? Okay. So let's see what the Torah says literally. Let's see what the Torah says literally about big people. So now it says over here, there's three people, sons of a giant. They're the offspring. Offspring means sons of the giant. Yildei Anak. Okay, great. So how big is Anak? So now they're telling us that if someone is Anak, and obviously their food also has to be Anak. The food also has to be big, right? ויבואו עד נחל אשכול ויחרטו משם זמורה ואשכול ענבים אחד ויסהו במות בשניים ומן הרימונים ומן התאנים. So it says they arrived at the valley of Eshkol and cut from there a vine with one cluster of grapes. One cluster of grapes is like, you know, one, you know, the thing that looks like a triangle. They cut one cluster of grapes and bore it on a double pole.
The famous picture. Yeah.
So they carried one thing of grapes. They needed to carry it on two poles. Eight people had to carry one thing of grapes. Eight people. Eight people had to carry one thing of grapes. And then two people for the pomegranates and two people for the fig. One pomegranate. No pomegranate. Rimon. Two people had to carry one rimon. And two people had to carry one fig.
Giant.
Okay, so let's continue. Hold on, hold on. We haven't gone to the real. And also, the way we know that. So somebody says, "Wait a minute, but how do you know?" You know, in English, I actually got this question today. It says over here in English, when they brought back the report to them and the entire assembly, meaning these spies came back to Am Yisrael after 40 days. And he brought the report, and they showed them the fruit of the land. They showed them the fruit of the land. Now, English is not like Hebrew. English, sometimes one word has multiple meanings. So fruit could really mean multiple, even though fruits is really the proper grammar to use, but you can use the word fruit to mean more than one fruit, meaning more than, let's say, one apple. In Hebrew, it's not like that. In Hebrew, the word for one, a single fruit, is pri. For multiple is perot. Two completely different words. So here in Hebrew, it's much, much clearer. It says, Vayashivu otam davar ve'et kol ha'edah ve'yirum et pri ha'aretz. Pri meaning one fruit. One fruit. Okay. So now, so far we have giants. We have giant fruit. But we don't really know how big these giants are yet. We're thinking maybe it's like the movie showed, let's say, Goliath. Goliath was big. You know, so if you have Goliath next to David, the way we saw it in the cartoons when we were little kids, mm-hmm. Goliath is like 30 feet tall. And David is 5 feet tall. So he's really tall and he's really short. That's what we think giants are. In our logic, right? So far, that's what makes sense to us. Mm-hmm. We're wrong. They're a little bigger.
Way bigger.
Let's see. So they're telling us, first they're saying, yes, Hashem is right about the land which you sent us to. It's indeed a flows with milk and honey. Yeah, it's Eretz Zavat Chalav Udvash. It's the land of milk and honey. This is its fruit. Okay, great. אפס כי אז העם היושב בארץ והערים בצורות גדולות מאוד וגם ילדי הענק ראינו שם. It says, but the people that dwell in the land are powerful and the cities are fortified and very great, and we also saw the offspring of the giant. Okay? We still haven't gotten the answer yet. How big is this giant? So now it's starting to, with the bad report. ויציאו דיבת הארץ אשר תר אותה את בני ישראל לאמור הארץ אשר עברנו בה לתור אותה ארץ אוכלת יושביה היא וכל העם אשר ראינו בתוכה אנשי מידות. So it's saying here, the land through which we have passed to spy it out is a land that devours its inhabitants, meaning the land eats its people. We'll explain what that means in a second. All the people that we saw in it were huge. Vesham ra'inu et ha-nefilim, which are mentioned in Parashat Noach, b'nei anak, min ha-nefilim, v'nehi b'einenu k'chagavim, v'chen ha'inu b'einenu. So it says, all the people that we saw in there were huge. There we saw the Nephilim, the sons of the giant from among the Nephilim. We were like grasshoppers in our eyes, and so we were in their eyes. Meaning, we were like the size of a grasshopper next to them.
Wow.
It's a lot more than 30 feet. And this is the literal Torah. This is not Midrashim, Gemara, oral, mystical. This is Torah Bichtav.
Grasshopper.
So you imagine a grasshopper in comparison to you. That's the size difference between the Nephilim and us. So this is not, no one needs to.
No wonder you need eight people to.
No one needs to.
To carry a grape.
Right, exactly. No one needs to say, sense. Listen, the mystical part of the Torah is too much for me. Not too much, it's the Torah itself. It's the Torah itself. So what do they mean now? These spies are making a very dear mistake. They're scaring the entire nation of Israel, telling them that this land of milk and honey that Hashem promised us is a big mistake. We cannot go there because these giants live there and these other nations that are going to kill us, we can't beat them. So first of all, by saying that we can't beat them, what do they also mean?
They
Hashem can't beat them. They don't believe. They don't have their emunah issues.
Just a second, but you, before you say why from the start they go there,
yeah, we answered it.
Lama?
Because they didn't have emunah.
You
could go.
Hashem knows. Hashem says, listen, I'm promising you a land of milk and honey and everything's going to be fine. You have nothing to worry about. But I'm not going to stop you from practicing your own freedom of will. If you want to do something, do it. You want to do an avera, do an avera. You want to do a mitzvah, do a mitzvah. You want to do something good, do something. Hashem is going to tell you the information. He's telling you according to Torah, anyone that learns Torah day and night and really spends their entire life is guaranteed a lot of bar with a lot of good things. Whether you're going to do it or not is up to you. So Hashem told them the information. They didn't want to listen. They wanted to check it for their own eyes. They wanted to see it. So just like somebody says, I say to somebody, listen, there's proof in the Torah that Christianity and Islam is fake. It's proof in the Torah. They go, oh, I want to see it. I want to see the verse. I want to see the verse. Okay, so you show them the verse. There's proof in the Torah that, I don't know, a million other things. Come up, ask a question, there's a proof in the Torah about it.
Yeah.
Oh, I want to see it. I want to see it. Does it make a difference if I show it to them? Did it make it more real or not? Because I showed it to them? No, it was already real, but they wanted to see it with their own eyes. Same thing with Am Yisrael, they wanted to see it with their own eyes. That wasn't their mistake. Seeing it with their own eyes, fine, it's human nature. It's not exactly, it's not logical because they're seeing miracles every day from Hashem. It's not logical that they still went there. But they went. Fine. That wasn't the mistake. The mistake was that when they came back and said bad things about Am Yisrael, bad things about the...
They should just listen from the beginning. Milk and
the land of Israel.
This is the land of...
So as they start telling us that, no, we cannot go there. The land is full of giants that kill us. And the land, this land, devours its inhabitants. Meaning the land is killing its inhabitants. What do they mean? This is a lack of understanding of what, how bad our logic can get us. So when they came to Canaan, Hashem knows if these giants see these Jews, they're going to try to kill them. Mm-hmm. So what does he do? So he kills a bunch of giants. Hashem kills a bunch of giants. So now the giants are busy doing funerals for their friends that just died. So now the Jews are coming, and they see that everywhere they go, they see giants, but there's always a funeral. So they're thinking that instead of Hashem kill these giants for us, so these giants are too busy with the funeral, they're not going to see us walking around. Instead of thinking that, they're thinking, oh, this land is even killing giants. If it's killing giants, of course it's going to kill us. That's the problem with our logic. That's the problem with our logic. And you see that every day.
The question now, it's also how they was like so important people. They're supposed to be the most with the most faith from all the nation.
Most knowledge.
With the most
knowledge. Knowledge, not lo emunah, de'ah, dor de'ah.
Dor de'ah.
לא, נא, לא,
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 אני מדבר, עזוב על זה שיש להם השפעה, אני מדבר על העניין שהם אמורים להיות אחרי כל, עזוב את כל הניסים שהם אמורים והכל, הם גם בעלי מעמד, אז הם אמורים להיות עם הכי הרבה אמונה, איך זה שהם באים לבלבל את כל העם בצורה כזאת?
That's the good question. And this is the question that you're asking is a good question. How is it that the nation of Israel that saw Hashem's words in Mount Sinai, heard His words, saw food coming from Shemaim every single day,
open the sea,
saw the sea split, saw all these amazing miracles every day, every day. How is it that they not only sinned, but one after another, after another, after another? In this particular parasha, Hashem says, how long is it that this nation is going to sin for me? As I've already suffered 10 of them, 10 times they went against me. Since Egypt, 10 times just since Egypt, in a matter of a short period of time, a year, they went against Hashem 10 times with the golden calf, with questioning about the water, food, everything. And now this. How? Miracles do not make people stay religious. That's the answer. Miracles do not make people stay religious. A miracle may get someone to do something, like go to Beit Knesset once or twice, or even for 6 months, keep Shabbat for a year, or 6 months, or 2 weeks, but it's not going to make him religious. It's not going to make him stay that way. A good thing that happens, whether it's winning the lotto, or coming back to life, from death, is not going to make someone religious. What makes someone religious is learning Torah. Ein ma'al etz chassid, meaning there's no such thing as an ignorant, righteous person. Someone that wants to be religious has to learn Torah. Has to learn Torah every day. 5 minutes, 10 minutes, an hour a day, 5 hours, whatever you want. Has to have a little bit of Torah every single day in order for them to stay religious. So then you ask me, well, how do you explain some of these people that go to Beit Knesset on Shabbat, and they keep Shabbat? They keep Shabbat. But these people, maybe they read Torah twice a year. How do you explain that? Well, first of all, there's also things that have become part of our culture. Some people are in certain communities, it's easier for them to keep Shabbat. But Shabbat is a big part of Judaism. It's not all of it. There's a lot more to it. You also see the opposite. You see people that go to Netz Tefillah, the prayer of Netz, at 5 o'clock in the morning, but they don't keep Shabbat. Meaning that these people just make up their own rules, whatever's convenient for them. So Shabbat sometimes happens to be convenient. Shabbat happens to be something they like. You see some people driving on Shabbat to Beit Knesset. So they like the Shabbat concept, but the keeping Shabbat, no, not so much. In order for someone to be religious, to be a Torah observant Jew, to be a righteous Jew, with a chance to get to Olam Haba, they must learn Torah every single day, a little bit every day. Must. Let's not fool ourselves and think that there's another way. There isn't another way. There isn't another way. If you want to have a chance of getting to Olam Haba, you must learn some level of Torah every day. It's a reality. This may be more difficult for some people than keeping Shabbat. This may be more difficult for people than keeping kosher. Maybe, I don't know. I don't know why, but sometimes it's difficult for people. Something is difficult for one person, it's not difficult for another. Something is easy for one person, it's not easy for another. Different. But the point is what Hashem is telling us here, is that in order for Am Yisrael to be righteous, they must have the Torah in them at all times, because the miracles will not do it. Because even the generation that saw all the miracles, every miracle you could imagine they saw, every day they saw miracles. Every day they saw miracles. There wasn't a minute that went by they didn't see a miracle. All the time miracles. But they didn't do anything for them. They still made giant sins that even today we wouldn't do. You're going to go pray to some calf, golden calf. You're going to go and you heard Hashem say that He's giving the nation of Israel, the land of Israel to you. You're going to go and say bad things about it. Hashem took you out of Egypt. You're going to complain that maybe He's going to starve you to death in the middle of the desert. You're not going to do that. You're going to be crazy. But they made those sins. It's a reality. They made those sins. Reasons and whys of why they made those sins is a different story. But the point is that the miracles by themselves did not make people religious. And that's one of the things that we have to understand about ourselves. That sometimes people do tshuva because they want something from God. God, please give me panasa. And all of a sudden they say, you know what? If I just ask, it's not enough. So you know what? Maybe I'm going to start eating kosher and giving some tzedakah, and then Hashem is going to give me panasa. Then another guy is saying, God, please, 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 please give me a child. He says, you know what, just asking is not enough, so you know what, I'm going to start keeping Shabbat. And then another guy says, God, please, please, please give me a zivug. That guy says, you know what, from now on, I'm going to go to mikveh, I'm going to do tefillin, and I'm going to keep Shabbat. These three people, great. Then Hashem gives it to them. What keeps them there? Now they got what they want. One guy got zivug, one guy got child, another guy got the panasa. What keeps them religious? Because they already got what they want. Without Torah, it's only a matter of time before they become even worse. Remember this. Even worse than they were before they got it. Not the same. Without Torah, they will become worse in more cases than not. And the reason why is because now that you have the money, your Yetzirah has much bigger potential. Now that you have the woman, your Yetzirah has much more desires. Now that you have the child, your influence on the world is much, much greater. And that's why there's a rabbi that just died about 10 years ago, said something scary. Mama's scary. He said, if a parent treats their child like their friends, they're raising mini Hitlers.
Always with them.
If the father treats their child, their boy or their girl, as if they're friends, not as a father or mother, as if they're friends, they're raising mini Hitlers that when they grow up, they will become Hitler. Obviously, it's not his own opinion. He gets this from the Torah. We saw this from David HaMelech. Who is more righteous than David HaMelech? Who? Find somebody in any generation who's more righteous than David HaMelech. The person didn't even know what sin is. He made a mistake with one of his children. He didn't say no to him. He gave them everything. He wanted something, he gave it to him. He wanted something, he gave him everything. Everything, everything. What happens? That child tried killing his father. Avshalom tried killing David HaMelech. David HaMelech! If David HaMelech made this mistake, Why can't we learn from it? So again, to be religious, maybe getting Hashem saving you from, if you have the schut, Be'ezrat Hashem, something bad's supposed to happen, Hashem stops it in the middle. He says, listen to me. Wake you up. I'm not going to let you die. I'm not going to let you lose. I'm not going to let something bad happen to you. And dafka, I'm going to give you something good. Okay. Hashem, I'm going to start keeping Shabbat. Hashem, I'm going to start doing tefillin. Hashem, I'm going to keep kosher. Hashem, I'm going to do something extra. Something I'm not doing. Great start. But a Jew must continue to progress and add more and more to what he's doing. He cannot stay where he is. He cannot just do tefillin and Shabbat and that's it. It's impossible. He has to continue adding over time, every so often. Okay, I'm doing Shabbat for a while. Okay, now I'm going to do tefillin. I'm doing tefillin now. Now I'm going to do tefillah three times a day instead of only once a day. Or twice a day instead of once. Okay, I'm doing tefillah three times a day, Shabbat, tefillin. Now I'm going to make sure I'm going to makpid on kosher. Okay, so doing kosher. Now, okay, I'm doing kosher, I'm doing tefillin, I'm doing Shabbat, I'm doing tefillah. Okay, I learned some Torah. I'm going to do 15 minutes a day. Okay, I'm doing 15 minutes a day. I'm doing Shabbat, I'm doing tefillin, I'm doing this. But everything else became normal already. Keeping tefillin is not so hard anymore. Keeping Shabbat is not so much anymore. Come to your own class, Be'ezrat Hashem, but that's only once a week. Be'ezrat Hashem will have the ability to do seven times a week. But the key here is that you're doing a little bit, but the difficulty of Shabbat is not difficult anymore. Why? Because she's part of your life already. To do tefillin is not difficult anymore. Why? Because it's part of your life already. Kosher? Why would I eat anything else? I don't want to eat taref, chas v'chalil. I want to eat bugs. Man, it's crazy. A year ago, you would have never said that. Wow, McDonald's, delicious. Now you see McDonald's, chas v'chalil. Ooh, who eats the stuff? Miskinim. It's normal to you. That's why you have to continue adding. Continue adding, because that's what keeps you in the game. That's what gets you to Olam Haba. That's what gets you to win. So someone says, listen, I don't want to be a major tzaddik. I want to be normal. I want to be normal. I want to do basic. I want to do Shabbat. I want to do tefillin, the basic minimum. What's the answer to that person? How are you with your job? In your job, you just go to your job. You say, no. Sir, Mr. Boss, I don't want to be a millionaire. I just want to make $5 an hour. No, but I want to give you $1 million. $1 million an hour. No, I don't need $1 million. You keep it for yourself, please. I just want to make $5. Doesn't make any sense, right? Why? Because you would never do it. It's the same thing what Hashem is telling us. Hashem is telling us, I want to give you $1 million a minute. $1 million a minute. And you only want to take $5? Doesn't make any sense. It's obviously the Yetzer HaRa talking. It cannot be someone logical. So this is what happened with these miraglim. They saw the miracles. They were tzaddikim. But also the Gemara tells us that the bigger the righteous person, the bigger is Yetzirah. And that Yetzirah continues to grow with the mitzvot. But he's not Yetzirah, the same type of Yetzirah as a regular person. A regular person, he has Yetzirah all the time and you just can't beat him. McDonald's, he has to eat it. Shrimp, he has to do it. A woman, he has to be with. Everything he has to do it. He just has no control. He becomes one of Yetzirah's soldiers. He's one of his employees. But a tzaddik doesn't work for the Yetzirah. Tzaddik learns Torah all the time. So how could a tzaddik make such a sin? How could a tzaddik go against Hashem in such a way that he tells the nation of Israel, do not go into this place. Hashem brought us here to kill us. He saved us to kill us. How could somebody do that? Chazal explains to us that the Yetzirah and the tzaddikim is bigger, much, much bigger than a regular person. But he stays dormant. He stays sleeping, waiting for the final right moment to attack. Waiting for the moment to attack when it creates the biggest amount of damage. He won't attack him every day. He won't bother him whether he wants to do tefillin or not do tefillin. He knows he's going to do tefillin. He knows he's going to beat him anyway. He knows he's not going to eat chametz on Pesach. Yeah. He knows he's not going to eat pork. He knows he's not going to be in look with his woman. He knows he's not going to do all these bad things. So he's not going to bother him with that stuff. But he's going to wait when he's not expecting him to create the biggest damage. And that's why I'm telling you this today. We need to learn it. Very, very important for our generation. Because right now, chaval, but there's bad stories in the world, the Jewish world today, coming from big rabbis that are doing, making mistakes, famous names, people that are mekubalim, people that are good people. But unfortunately, they are failing at certain tests. They're making mistakes. So if you happen to see one of these reports, because of course the Yetzer Hara is also a very good journalist. He's not only the one that makes people sin, he's also the one that influences the journalist to be there at that time so he can write it and do a big Chilul Hashem on the internet to publicize it to the world. So if you happen to see one of these articles where you see, oh, this rabbi did this, this rabbi did this, this rabbi did this, remember this parasha. You cannot judge someone unless you are in his shoes. Don't think that just because this rabbi did something or you heard it, first of all, don't believe it's true 100%. Doesn't mean it's true just because somebody said it. Number two, even if it's true, who are we to judge them? We don't have the Yetzirah. Our Yetzirah is tiny next to theirs. We're here, they're here. Why? Because they're much bigger tzaddikim than we are. You have to judge someone based on their entire life. And also remember that the way you judge other people is the way you're going to be judged in Shamayim. If you give people schut, when you go up to Shamayim, Hashem will give you schut. You don't give people schut, Hashem won't give you schut. So remember that. So you're going to see some stories that are heartbreaking and a real tragedy. But don't jump to conclusions. Don't...
What's schut?
Schut meaning benefit of the doubt. Give them the benefit of the doubt that there could be it could be better than what it seems like. So for example, if you see your kid, you come into the house and you see your kid and there's glass all over the floor and you see your kid picking it up. Now immediately, you're thinking that if you're not giving your kid any schut, you're not giving your kid any benefit of the doubt, you think that your kid broke everything and she did it or he did it, right? But if you wait a few minutes, reflect, and ask them what happened, then they tell you the story. Well, actually, Abba, when I came home, I saw the dog jump and the dog, pushed the whole thing down. So then you know the real story. Sometimes it takes a little time to get the real story. So giving someone the benefit of the doubt
is
always to our benefit. It's called kav schut in Judaism, where we're actually obligated to do it. It's if someone that can use their imagination to give people schut, they're guaranteed Olam Haba. So now, unfortunately, these people sinned in a very, very big way. And Hashem not only got upset, but Hashem wanted to exterminate Am Yisrael. It says here, Vayomer Adonai Moshe, Adana, Inaotzuni Ha'am Hazeh, V'Adana, Lo Ya'aminu Bi, Bechol Ha'otot Asher Asiti Bekirbo.
Kinnu.
Hashem said to Moses, how long will this people provoke me? And how long will they not have faith in me, despite all the signs that I have performed in their midst? All the miracles I give these people and they still don't believe in me. That's what Hashem is telling Moshe. And this is the part that's mamash we have to remember every day. Because unfortunately sometimes we learn the wrong Torah. Unfortunately, sometimes we learn something called, that people call it Torah, but it's not really Torah. Sometimes people teach nice things that have a little bit of Torah in it, but it's not the truth. And that's what the Me'aglim did. They tell you a story, they say, oh, they mention Moshe Rabbeinu, they mention Avraham Avinu, they mention something like Kaf Zchut, they mention a verse like, Kol Yehudi Yesh Lo Chelek Le'Olam Haba. They mention something nice. But they forget to mention the rest of the story, because the rest of the story is something they make up. Like, Kol Yehudi Yesh Lo Chelek Le'Olam Haba, and that's it. They don't tell you the rest of the verse is that these are the people that do not have Chelek Le'Olam Haba. And it tells you all the list of all the people who do not have Chelek Le'Olam Haba. It's not just every Jew has Chelek Le'Olam Haba. That's a lie. That's just the first part of the verse. The real part is These are the people who do not have it. Michalei Shabbat, all those people that we talk about every week, we learn all those main terrible things. They go against Hashem. Chilul Hashem, Zera Levatala, all these people. That's in there. But someone says, Kol Yehudi Yesh L'Chelek L'Olam Ba, every Jew has a Chelek L'Olam Ba, and tells you that's the complete verse? That's a lie. So it's Torah, a little bit of Torah full of lies. We have to make sure to stay away from that. We have to make sure to know the truth. The Torah has good and has punishment. Has reward and has punishment. If there wasn't a reward and punishment, Hashem, Chas v'Chalila, would be a liar. To say that there's no punishment would be calling Hashem a liar. Why? Because he's telling us to do all these mitzvot, and you gotta go to Gan Eden. But then if you don't do any mitzvot, you still go to Gan Eden. So Moshe Rabbeinu knew the same thing. You killed 6 million people like Hitler. Moshe Rabbeinu saved 6 million people. Both go to Gan Eden, hang out together, play basketball. How does this make any sense? How does this make any sense to anybody? Can't. So this verse over here we're about to read is more than enough proof. There has to be a punishment. There has to be some type of consequences. Why? Because if Hashem only said good things about us, if Hashem only said warnings, like what I just read, how long will these people provoke me and how long will they not have faith in me? You know, pretty much you're annoying me right now. If that was it, maybe every Jew does have a Chalabah. Maybe. But let's see what it says now. Hakenu v'devir v'orishenu v'eseh otcha legoy gadol v'atzum mimenu. I will smite them with the plague and annihilate them. And I shall make you a greater and more powerful nation than they. Hashem is telling Moshe Rabbeinu, I will destroy this nation called Israel, and I will start a new nation from you that will be better than them. This is not the first time he told them this. Yeah. He also told them this in Al Sinai. Hashem has already been hot on Am Yisrael for a while already.
It's the second time.
He says, I'm going to destroy them and start a new nation from you because you are tzaddik. Moshe Rabbeinu tzaddik, Yeshua ben Nun tzaddik, Caleb is tzaddik. They're all tzaddikim. I'll start a new nation from you. If there was no such thing as punishment, why would Hashem such a thing? If he didn't care that Michalid Shabbat, no Michalid Shabbat, why would he say I'll destroy all of them? So Moshe Rabbeinu starts pleading. But there's something interesting about this verse on the mystical side of the Gemara explains, very, very interesting. It says, I will smite them. In Hebrew, I will smite them is akenu badevil. Akenu badevil can mean, I will smite them, I will destroy them. But what does it mean, I will hit them with devil? Devil is a...
from Egypt.
How do you say it in English? Hail. Hail.
Ah, okay.
Hail, the ice.
Yeah.
Ice?
No, Balad.
Devil is the bug. Devil is the mushroom.
Okay, forget it. My chidush wasn't complete. Forget it. It doesn't apply, actually. Forget it. My bad. Anyway, Hashem is putting us in a situation now. Well, actually, we've put ourselves in a situation now that we only have one shot. Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu can either say, yes, Hashem, you know what? Let's start a new nation with me. Me, Yeshua ben Nun. The women didn't sin, so the women stay around. The women didn't sin. Women didn't say anything bad. So it'll be all the women, Yeshua ben Nun, Caleb, Moshe, all the kids, all the children, because they didn't sin either. Just kill all the men. 20 years and older, done. So, Moshe Rabbeinu doesn't want to do this. He starts pleading with Hashem and he says to him, yeah, Hashem, if you kill them, Of course, you could do anything you want. But if you kill them, what are the other countries going to say? Everyone knows you took out Israel from Egypt, from slavery, and you saved them, opened miracles, you destroyed them, you freed us, you gave us the Torah, you did all these amazing things, and you promised us the nation, the land of Israel. So what are they going to say? That he took us out, he put us in a desert, we got to the border of Israel, Canaan, and he couldn't let us in. So he killed us instead. It becomes Chilul Hashem.
So this also I don't understand. I don't understand like what God needs to tell him this thing.
It's not about Hashem needing our prayers. It's Hashem wanting to hear our prayers. Hashem doesn't need...
It's not like a prayer. It's like he talked with him. It's like he gave him advice. This like the
that's what prayer used to be. Before the Chachamim put together Tefillat Shmona Esrei, the prayer was really in your own words. You would pray, you'd talk to Hashem like you and I are talking, but would ask, you know, ask Hashem for help. Hashem, please help me. I need help with Parnasa. Hashem, please help me. I need help with my wife. I need help with this. I need help in your own words. And we were able to connect to Hashem in a very, very deep level. The reason, one of the reasons why the Chachamim, why the sages came up with the Sidul is because we've dropped so low on the spiritual connection with Hashem that if I told somebody to pray to Hashem in their own words, maybe it will be a minute and a half to 2 minutes. Tefillah is not supposed to be a minute and a half to 2 minutes. You're asking Hashem to fix your entire world, your entire life, your entire everything. You're asking for 1 minute. It's a busha. So we give him a prayer where at least, you know what, we're figuring the guy's going to pray for an hour, he's going to pray for a half hour. We're hoping that within that half hour to an hour, it's going to be more than 2 minutes of mamash, you know, connection with Hashem. That's what we're hoping. Plus the sounds of the letters, somebody that pronounces the letters the right way. The Hebrew language is a holy language. Someone that pronounces the Hebrew letters in the right way, according to the Chazal, according to the sages, it's pleasing to Hashem to hear it. So, you're right that Hashem, that Moshe Rabbeinu is talking to Hashem like a regular person. And that was the unique part about Moshe Rabbeinu versus every other prophet that ever lived before him or after him. That Moshe Rabbeinu was able to talk to Hashem just like you and I are talking. He could talk to him like a, literally, in a normal way. And it's not that Hashem needed Moshe to remind him of anything. Hashem wanted to, Moshe Rabbeinu, to still want it. Hashem wanted to see Moshe Rabbeinu's emunah in his own nation. And really, the connection with his own nation, because as a leader, you always want to make sure that the leader is the right leader. If the leader loses hope in his people, he's not no longer the right leader. If you have a CEO of a company, you know, we're in business, we met a lot of different CEOs from all over the world. You have big CEOs, small CEOs, big companies, small companies. At the end of the day, it's all the same job. Whether it's construction, or it's software, or it's anything else, a CEO's job is the same job. You have to be a leader. If one day the CEO woke up and he no longer believed in his product, he no longer believed that they were the best, he no longer believed that he had the right people, one of two things has to happen at that point. Either the CEO has to step down and leave the company immediately, or there has to be a major reorganization within the company. Now you picked it again. That's my fault, not his fault.
It's not your fault.
So anyway, so as far as a CEO has to be a leader, has to believe in his people and his product. So the same thing with Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu has to believe in the nation of Israel, that they're still the right team. And he has to believe in the product, which is Torah. Now, of course, he believes in Torah. Hashem wants to hear this stuff to see if he still believes in his people. Because if he doesn't, we can replace him. Chas v'chalila, but that's what Hashem is telling him in so many words. So then someone would ask, okay, but wait a minute, what about the promise that he made, Avraham Avinu, Avraham Yitzhak and Yaakov, that your nation, your seed will continue forever? Well, that's why he's keeping Moshe Rabbeinu. Moshe Rabbeinu is from their seed. So technically he could still do it with Moshe Rabbeinu. So it's possible. It's v'chalila, but it's possible. Okay. So Moshe Rabbeinu says something very, very interesting to Hashem.
Huh?
Here's the thing. The punishments that we have in those days were immediate punishments. The punishments we have today take more time. There's a couple of reasons for that. First off, one of the reasons is that in those days they saw Hashem on a daily basis as far as his miracles and his works. Whereas in our generation, in our life, and ever since pretty much the Beit HaMikdash, Hashem's workings has been behind the scenes. We call him nature. You know, nature is what people give as the excuse for why things exist, why the world operates the way it does, why there's gravity, why there are animals fly, you know, birds fly from one place to another and they know what to do. Why the rooster always knows when it's sunrise. All these different things that happen, and people have an excuse that it's nature. Funny thing is that nature, Hateva, has a numerical value of 86, and so does the Shem Hashem, Elohim, is also 86. Meaning Hashem is nature. The only question is whether people will pay attention to the details and realize it or not. If you see some things in nature and you realize that there has to be a designer. So for example, you see that the level of oxygen in the atmosphere has to be 20%. If there was one more percent of oxygen, anyone that would light a match would burn the entire planet. One more percent. Now I'm not talking about 50 more percent. Or 100 more percent. One more percent. 20 to 21. Everyone burns up like that. It's like an atomic bomb from one match. One less percent, everyone dies.
Wow.
No one could breathe.
Wow.
1%. Most important resource that the world needs, that people need, that life needs, is water. And the only way that you can find if there's life somewhere is if there has to be water. Because life cannot exist without water. And that's why all of NASA and all of these people that, you know, spend their life looking for other life in other planets, they're not looking for people. They're not looking for UFOs and ships and Star Trek and guns and stuff like that. They're looking for water. Why? Because if there's water, there has to be life. It's the most important thing that we have for us. Without water, we cannot exist. What is the most abundant resource that the globe has? Water. More than 70% of the globe of Earth is water. So it's the most important, and that's what Hashem gives us the most of. In Parashat Bereshit, it says, V'amayim me'al ha-shamayim. Parashat Bereshit says that there's Hashem put water under the rakia, under the shamayim, and above the shamayim. So for many, many years, philosophers and scientists of all kinds, from old age and new age, have said, oh, we found a mistake in your Torah. Over here it says that Hashem, your God, said that there's water under the sky and there's water above the sky. Okay, well listen, water under the sky, I see, okay, I see an ocean, I see a river, I see a pool, fine, okay. 50% you're right. But where's the other water? And not only that, it says that the Shemayim, Me'al HaShemayim, are much greater than the Mayim over here. Meaning, the Chazal has explained to us that the water above Shemayim is in much larger quantity than the ocean we have here. Last, anyone check if there's an ocean in the moon? There's no ocean on the moon. Anyone check if there's ocean on Mars? There's no ocean on Mars. Where is there an ocean? Where is this Mayim? And not only is there Mayim, there's more Mayim there. There's more water over there. But oh, that's the mistake. See, we told you the book is not divine. So Chazal says, don't worry. There's Mayim, there's Mayim. In those days, we only had what the book said, what Chazal said, what Hashem said. We didn't have the technological equipment to prove it. Now we do. So the telescopes that we have today, we found out one thing that we always thought was strange, but never knew what it was. We found out what comets are. Sometimes you look at the sky and you see a shooting star. You see a star that is like a makes a mark behind them when it's moving, but it has like a little mark behind it. That's a comet. Interestingly about that comet, is that for many years we didn't know what that line was that it's making. Where is it, smoke coming out of it? What is it? With science today and telescopes today, we found out that all of that is water. Why? Because the comet is one giant ice. That's all it is. It's all ice. And at the time that it's making this mark, it's crossing in direct reflection with the sun. So it's melting much faster than it would melt naturally. That's what's making a huge amount of water comes out of it. Okay, so that's one piece of water. We found out that's above the Shemayim. Where's the rest? Bigger telescopes saw that the entire outer layer of the universe, of everything, is where all these comets are breaking off of. So these comets, that are giant things, they're just tiny, 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 small little pieces of this giant piece of ice that surrounds the entire universe. Much, much greater piece of ice, piece of water, than the water we could have here. Just one of those comets could be bigger than our ocean. So, all along, Chazal was right. All along, God was right. I guess because he put it there, I guess he knows. So now, going back into this parasha, you have Hashem is very angry. And now we ask ourselves, okay, listen, I make some sins, but Hashem will forgive me. I'll let it go once I go up there. Right, so a lot of people think, I'm not going to keep Shabbat, but when I get up there, I'll figure it out. So Moshe is trying to convince Hashem not to destroy Am Yisrael. Yigdal na koach Adonai, kasher dibart lehmo Adonai er hapayim v'raf chesed, noseh avon v'pesha, v'nake lo yinake, Poked avon avot al banim al shleshim v'al rebeim. So it says, Hashem is slow to anger. You say this in prayer a lot, by the way. Ech apayim v'raf chesed. Hashem is slow to anger. So he's not like a human being that gets mad really quickly. Abundant in kindness, doesn't stop giving us. Forgiver of iniquity, all of our flaws he forgives us. And even willful sin, even sin that we do dafka, he still forgives. And who cleanses, meaning the sins that we have, we could do tshuva. But it is the key. But does not cleanse completely. Meaning, yes, you sinned. Yes, I'll forgive. Yes, I'll wipe some of it off. But don't you think I'll wipe everything off for you. Does not cleanse completely, recalling the iniquity of parents upon children to the third and fourth generations. Very important for us to know that some people say that, listen, if you're a nice guy, Hashem will love you. Maybe he'll love you, but doesn't mean he's not going to punish you. In order for someone to live a kosher life, in order for someone to have a good shot at Gan Eden, Olam Haba, the good parts of the Torah, the promises of good in this world and the next world, they have to do what Torah says. There's no other way. It's the being nice, being rich, being, you know, all that stuff is not, doesn't buy you any brownie points. Because anyway, Hashem is giving it to you. So it's important for us to know that Hashem is not a human being that's just going to say, you know what? It's on me, don't worry about it. Oh, you can't pay back the loan? Don't worry about it, just declare bankruptcy. You don't have to pay the loan. Oh, you cheated on me? Okay, just tell me you love me and buy me a big diamond ring, and I'll forgive you. Unfortunately, that's what happens. You see celebrities all the time. What was it, a basketball player not too long ago, a few years ago? Cheated on his wife, got caught cheating on his wife. He bought her a $5 million diamond ring, and she forgave him, and now they're still married and everything is good. Everybody knew the size of the ring was like some pink diamond. If people like me knew that he bought her a $5 million ring, you know it was famous. Because I don't care about any of that stuff.
$5 million ring.
That's what I
am. So, again, silliness. Hashem is obviously not, doesn't do any of this nonsense. Hashem says you have certain things that you need to do in this world. And you must do them. But now, why is he mentioning this? Why is Moshe Rabbeinu mentioning this? That he cleanses the sins, but not all of them. Because Moshe Rabbeinu also knows that Hashem is, the meaning of truth is Hashem. He cannot do anything but the truth. And actually these things that he said are part of the 13 principles, the 13 things that are the descriptions of Hashem. So now, Moshe Rabbeinu is asking for forgiveness, but he knows that we can't just get away with this like it never happened. Because we did this sin intentionally. We knew what we were doing. These miraglim, these spies, knew what they were doing. They knew they went against Hashem. And not only they knew they were going against Hashem, they did something terrible. What did they do? What was so bad about what they did? Okay, so they said some bad things about the land of Israel. What was so bad? First of all, the reason why they did it. And second of all, the additions. So first, they said some things, okay, there's some good things about Israel. They brought the big grape. Okay, good news, we brought the grape. So there's good things about Israel. So already everybody's thinking, so Hashem, what Hashem said is true. There is this land and they have. It's a land of milk and honey. Great, good news. But then there's these giants, and these giants are going to kill us. And they did all these bad things are going to happen. And if we go there, they're going to kill us. And Hashem brought us here to punish us, and all these things. So now, when they showed them proof of something true, Am Yisrael automatically believed the rest of the story. And that's what makes a lie, a big lie, much worse than any typical lie. What's the significance? Why is there such success in Christianity or Catholicism or Islam or other major lies that have been throughout history? That all big lies have an element of truth in them. That's what makes a big lie a big lie. If I just tell you, listen, this is an airplane. Everyone's going to say, okay, it's time for your own to go to the hospital, hang out with the other mental institute people, and if there's a lot of shame, maybe you can give them some divrei Torah along with this airplane story. This is not an airplane. This is a lie. It's not an airplane. But if I said to you, this is a cup, but the cup has a special potion inside that if you drink it, you can live forever. You'd be a tzaddik, you know the entire Torah, you'd be the most handsome, pretty, whatever you want. That's a much more sophisticated lie, because I already started with the truth. I told you it's a cup, and I told you there's something in it. So already, there's a good chance you're going to believe that what I tell you, the rest of the description of what I tell you is real. Same thing with Christianity, Catholicism, Islam. They all said, yes, listen, the Torah, the first book, that's the first book. Yeah, Torah is true. Musa, Moshe Rabbeinu. Yeah, Musa, they call Moshe Rabbeinu Musa.
Musa.
Oh, he's good. Peace be upon him. And, Abraham, you know, they'd say nice things about, oh, everything, yeah, no, the Jews are good, Yehud's good, it's good. Same thing with Christians, oh, yeah, Abraham, and David, and Solomon, and all these things, yeah, good people, great, I love the book. We just had a second book. So, they start with a big lie by saying, all that's true, but is the... So if that's true, then the rest of what we're saying to you is also true. And unfortunately, most people don't check. How do we know most people don't check? Because we didn't check most of our life. Because the people that... Even the people that believe the stuff don't check. So that's what makes a big lie a big lie. And that's what actually happened with this Meraglim. They showed something true. They showed the grape. But they added a bunch of lies. They said there's giants. But the giants didn't try to kill them. They said that there's big things there, but the land didn't kill people. They just made that up. They added different things to the story. And that's a big problem. That's one of the parts of the... That was a giant problem that created. The second thing is that they publicized this to the entire nation. Made a big chilul Hashem. Went against Hashem publicly. If they really saw what they saw, and let's say what they said was true, should have talked to Moshe Rabbeinu and figure out a way, a strategy to tell the rest of the people. Not start crying in front of everyone and cause massive hysteria. And that's another problem of how they delivered the message.
I learned also that they do it because they want to keep about them...
the job. So the reason of why they did what they did is because since each one of them was a leader of thousands of people, they had good jobs. They were very important. Chashuvim. They had money, family, respect, everything you want. They had food coming from Shamayim every day. They had miracles every day. Seeing Hashem's words, pillar of clouds, pillar of fire. Good deal. It's great to be in the desert. When Hashem is carrying you in a cloud, you never have to do laundry. Never have to clean your clothes. Never have to take a shower. You're always clean because there's a cloud that's washing you constantly. You have food coming from Shemayim. You don't have to work. All you have to do is learn Torah all day. It's great. Good deal. Why do I want to change that? And on top of it, I'm the leader? So everybody gives me extra respect? Who wants to change that? They knew that once they go out into Eretz Yisrael, all that changes. So they didn't want to do it. They didn't want to change. They wanted to keep their job. So, part of the reason of why they lied, why they did what they did, was because they knew if we convince everyone not to go, then we could stay the leaders. And that was a big part of the sin. So Hashem punishes them, punishes the entire nation, and he says the entire nation, he's not going to destroy them, but all of the people that were part of this report from the age of 20 and above, with the exception of Yeshua ben Nun, Joshua ben Nun, son of Nun,
the women and
Caleb, and the women, and the children, and anyone below 20 years old, everyone else will die in the desert. They will die over the next 39 years. They will never see the land that they spoke bad about. They will never see the land of Israel. They will all die. And the people that actually did the lying, the other 10 people, the 10 people that were leaders, died instantly. Died immediately. Yeah, Hashem put a plague on them and killed them right away. So why did he wait 40 years for one and then instantly for the others? Because the ones that, you know, the ones that died instantly was because they created this whole massive hysteria, disaster, Chilul Hashem. They deserve to die right away. There is no tshuva for them. The other ones were influenced by others. It wasn't necessarily as intentional as the others. So he still gives them the benefit of the doubt where they're still, there's going to be punishment, but not a permanent punishment like the ones that caused other ones to sin. This teaches us the significance of someone who's a machtia rabim, someone who causes other people to sin. Unfortunately, in this world, we have some people that influence other people to sin. There are a certain level of sin. There are certain people that sin, and there are certain people that cause other people to sin. And there are certain people that literally influence people to sin. Making a sin is not good. Being mechalel Shabbat is not good. Eating non-kosher is not good. All of these sins, the Torah says, you can't do it, it's no good. It's bottom line, it's not what I said, it's what the Torah says. But causing other people to sin, there's no one worse than you in the world. Someone that keeps Shabbat, but a friend of his comes over to his house, hey, come on, smoke a cigarette with me. Be a mechalel Shabbat with me. Go to the beach with me. Go sin with a woman with me. Go whatever, do something. Make a sin with me. Someone that does that, their clothes can get the biggest punishment, which is in this world, which is closing the gates of tshuva. Meaning that even to do tshuva will be difficult for them. And the punishment as far as the next world, it's the worst one. It's eternal. It's eternal punishment. So some of you guys have asked me in the past, actually one of the people that asked me is not even here. It's fine. Hopefully he watches it. Or we can tell him this time. But we talked in one of the lectures. Again, I really don't mean to be scary, but this is really just what the Torah says. I don't know what to tell you guys. It's scary if you don't do it. I don't know. But anyway, the... Yeah, eat some food. Maybe it'll cheer you up. So now, someone asked me one time about how could it be that the Torah says that certain punishments are eternal, meaning it never ends. How could a punishment never end?
Shimon.
So in this parasha, it answers that question about punishment. So here it says, "Ki devar Adonai baza." So it says, for he scorned the word of Hashem and broke his commandments, that person will surely be cut off. His sin is upon him. Okay, so first he says, this is talking about someone who intentionally did idol worship. Someone who intentionally went against Hashem. Which, by the way, idol worship, Chilul Shabbat, accounting as one and the same thing. Just anybody who doesn't know, oh, Mechalel Shabbat, it's one thing, worshipping an idol is something different. It's not. It's two the same thing. Avodah Zarah is the same thing. So if someone is Mechalel Shabbat, same thing as someone that's worshipping something, some statue that they bought from Chinatown. Or working for the rats, like we talked about last week. So now, someone that intentionally did that, it says he's going to be cut off. But then it says that the sin is upon him. So how could somebody's already cut off? Meaning he died, he's cut off, he's not part of the nation, no good. Okay, great. What does it mean if sin is still upon him? Avunava. It means that the sin stays with him permanently. The punishment for the sin stays permanently. This is one of the references that happens to be in this parasha about the eternal punishment. This is obviously assuming someone who did not do tshuva. There's not a Hashem. We all do tshuva every single day. Not a Hashem will finish in about 10 minutes. So you guys could get that extra boost of energy now to finish all this. Don't fall asleep on me now. Stay with me. Another interesting thing about the parasha is that sometimes people have a trouble with understanding how Hashem works as far as, well, listen, if you look at the world today, unfortunately a large majority of the Jewish people are not following Torah and Mitzvot.
A lot.
So what, are you telling me Hashem is going to punish all of them? Be'ezrat Hashem, they all do tshuva.
Amen.
But assuming that people don't do tshuva, yes. This parasha shows us Hashem is one of many examples in the Torah that he's more than willing to do it. Not wanting, but he's going to do it. How? Where he says, when he's going to punish the entire nation, he says, if you shall come to the land about which I have raised my hand in an oath to settle there, except for Caleb and Joshua ben Nun. So he says that pretty much he was telling us here, they would kill everyone in essence, he would destroy everyone, except Caleb and Joshua, and Moshe Rabbeinu obviously. So we're talking about a much larger percentage than now. We're talking about 99% of the people. We're just going to start a nation between them and the women. So obviously, if Hashem's truth goes to that measure, it's measure for measure. Hashem's truth has no limits. So that's one thing we have to understand, is that even Hashem is only has a measure of truth. Which means that even if there's only two Jews left in the entire nation, he'd still do it. Because for him, it cannot go; it cannot be untrue. He cannot do anything that's against his own rules. So now, Moshe Rabbeinu comes to Am Yisrael and he tells them, listen guys, Hashem said that you made not only a big mistake, but you're going to pay for it and you're going to be in a desert for the next 39 years. You're going to be in a desert for 40 years. And you're all going to die in the desert. None of you are going to go to Eretz Yisrael, except the children, the women, whoever lives. You know, they live a normal life. Some people still died in the desert because they were old already. But the men that are above, that are part of the sin, no chance. So what do? They try going, no, we don't want this punishment. We believe him. We're going to go to Israel. We want it now. And they start going to Israel. They go against, they sin again. They go against Hashem's words again. He just told them, listen, you're punished, but he's not going to kill you. You're going to die over 40 years. You're going to have a life just in the desert for 40 years. You're not going to have the promise that he gave. You're not worthy. You're not the generation that's worthy of getting this reward, of getting Eretz Yisrael. You're going to die in the desert, but you're not going to die now. Instead of saying, okay, thank God, Baruch Hashem, at least we're going to live another 40 years. We have a chance to do tshuva. We have a chance to learn more Torah. We have a chance to do more mitzvot. And we have a big world, next world. Instead, what do? They go sin again. They go against Israel. No, we want it. And they start going towards Israel. And they go into Moshe Rabbeinu tells them, don't go there because
that's it.
They're going to kill you. Hashem is not going to be with you. And whatever those Melagrim, those spies said about the other nations being strong will come true. They will kill you. And they go there and they start killing them. So this is showing that why did Hashem allow this to happen?
The giants.
Because Hashem said that tshuva has existed even before this world. So how come we didn't accept this tshuva? When they said, no, we want to go. We sinned. They said, chatanu. Now we want to go into Israel. So how come you didn't accept their tshuva? Because their tshuva wasn't real. Meaning, they did a tshuva. It wasn't a full tshuva. Their tshuva was, they finally figured out that they made a mistake, and now they're not going to get the reward of going to Israel because of this mistake. So now they know that what they're missing on, now they're going to, now we want it. They didn't really do a tshuva because they made a mistake and they went against Hashem. That they didn't care about. They cared about the fact that they're not getting the reward. When someone does tshuva, they have to do a real tshuva. The real tshuva is several different steps. First of all, it's acknowledging that you made a mistake. That you did something wrong against Hashem. Hashem said, don't be a mechal Shabbat, be a mechal Shabbat. Hashem said, don't eat kosher, you didn't eat kosher. Hashem said, don't do this, you did. What you did, you have to repent for it. So first thing is acknowledging the mistake. Second of all, is feeling sorry for making that mistake. And third of all, is promising that you're not going to make the mistake again. And living a life in accordance to trying your best not to make that mistake. So when you're just saying, no, because I know I'm not going to get my reward, therefore, that's why I want to do tshuva, that's not real tshuva. So the last thing we're going to say, we talked about this before, but this is something again that I think is important for anyone that hasn't heard it here before or on the internet hasn't heard it. In this week's parasha, right after Hashem talks about the punishment for idol worship, right after Hashem talks about how the converts have the same rules as the natural born Jews, same Torah, same rules, same reward, same punishment, same thing. So no convert for any generation could ever say, no, I'm a convert, so I don't have to do, I just have to do the conversion. But I don't have to really keep Shabbat after. Just for the conversion, for the looks. For the rabbis, I'm going to put a kisur rosh, but after I do the conversion, no, I don't have to put the kisur rosh anymore. For the rabbis, I have to learn some Torah, but after that, I don't have to learn Torah anymore. So no convert would ever have these silly thoughts. Hashem specifically says here, the converts, their Torah, and the Torah of the people that are natural born Jews are one and the same. The reward and punishment is one and the same. They must be together, they must be, realize that it's the same thing. After he talks about that, he talks about the punishment of Avodah Zarah. And lastly, he talks about the first Mechalel Shabbat in history. His name was Tzlofchad. It says, Vayu Bnei Yisrael b'midbar, v'imtzeu ish, מקושש עצים ביום השבת והקריבו אותו המוצאים אותו מקושש עצים אל משה ואל אהרון ואל כל העדה ויניחו אותו במשמר כי לא פורש מה יעשה לו. ויאמר אדוני אל משה, מות יומת האיש, רגום אותו באבנים כל העדה מחוץ למחנה. ויוציאו אותו כל העדה אל מחוץ למחנה, וירגמו אותו באבנים וימות כאשר ציווה אדוני את משה.
This is the same guy you told me the story. It's the guy who said he was like a tzaddik?
Yes.
Is this?
Yes, he was a righteous person. According to the Gemara, he was a very righteous person.
Wait, he is the first Shabbat after we receive the Torah. Because before we receive the Torah, obviously people are Mechala Shabbat.
There's no such thing as Mechala Shabbat before the Torah. So he's the first Mechala Shabbat after we... It was the first Shabbat we kept. Second Shabbat, he was a Mechala Shabbat. So it says over here, to anyone who doesn't understand Hebrew, the children of Israel were in the wilderness.
Is this the second Shabbat?
This is the second Shabbat.
Didn't take long at all.
First Shabbat we all kept, second Shabbat.
That's why Adam and Eve didn't take too long.
First Shabbat we all kept, second Shabbat was violation. If we kept the second Shabbat, that's why this Chazal says that if we ever keep two Shabbat in a row, Mashiach will come. No,
Kol HaYudim.
Today it's not possible.
It's not Hashem. No, it's not Hashem. It can happen. It can happen, but...
After Mashiach, when people see the Shabbat.
After Mashiach, there's no more Shabbat though. So here's the thing. Let's go back to the subject at hand, because if you guys have more time, we can continue talking and ask more questions. But if you guys want to go, then let's try to finish this part. The children of Israel were in the wilderness, and they found a man gathering wood on the Sabbath day. Those who found him gathering wood brought him to Moses and Aaron and the entire assembly. They placed him in custody, for it had not been clarified what should be done to him. Hashem said to Moses, "The man shall be put to death. The entire assembly shall pelt him with stones outside of the camp." The entire assembly removed them to the outside of the camp. They pelted him with stones and he died, as Hashem had commanded Moses. So now, many people claim that they do not know what's the significance of not keeping Shabbat. Obviously, these people didn't read the Torah. And sometimes people that don't know the Torah, they make their own rules based on something they heard from someone who doesn't really know themselves, who said that they heard from somebody who does know. And they heard of this something called Gemara. And Gemara is just a bunch of arguments between a bunch of rabbis. And they make it this whole tiny, tiny bit of truth, which is like 1% truth, into one giant lie, just like the Meraglim. Why did the Meraglim put the entire nation into a panic? Because everyone believed them. Why did everyone believe them? Because there was a little bit of truth in a huge lie. So that's what these people do. They say, no, I heard that it's only the rabbis made up the Shabbat rule. It's not really that bad. So for those specific people, they should read this verse, Sefer Bamidbar, Pasuk Lamed Bet Ad Lamed Vav, or Book of Numbers, 15:32 until 36. And this tells what Hashem thinks of a Mechalel Shabbat, and what Hashem did to a Mechalel Shabbat, not just what he thinks, what he did. First Mechalel Shabbat, so this, if anyone was ever going to get the benefit of the doubt that they can make a mistake, if anyone was going to get, you know what, don't worry about it. You know what, it's only been one Shabbat that we kept, it's only the second one. It's not a big deal yet. If we've been keeping Shabbat for 40 years and you're Mechalel Shabbat now, then obviously it's a problem. It's only the second one. You only learned how to ride the bicycle. It's only new. So if Hashem was ever going to say there's an exception, no big deal, this is the guy you should have let him go. This is the guy you should have said, you know what, Slofchad's a righteous person, which we learn later on is it's a righteous person. Slofchad is a good guy. Slofchad didn't do it on a bunch of different things. You could give any number of excuses of why you should let him go. Especially the fact that it was only the second Shabbat. We're new. It's not like if you go to a job, your first day you make a mistake on your second day. They're not going to fire you after your second day. Okay, you made a mistake. Okay, with experience, you're going to do better. So if Hashem was ever going to let it go, this is the guy who's going to let it go. But instead, what is Hashem saying to Moshe Rabbeinu when Moshe Rabbeinu says, okay, we have a Mechalel Shabbat, what should we do with him? It's not, he didn't ask him, what should we do with him? Should we kill him or not? That wasn't the question. The question, what should we do with him, is that of course your Torah is truth, and your Torah says we have to kill him. Which way of punishment? What form of punishment does he get? What form of death? And of course he dies. But what form of death? So Hashem says, not only death, the worst one. Kill him in front of everyone with the worst type of death there is. So, for anyone that has a little bit of sense, a little bit of belief that this Torah is real, should understand. Drive on Shabbat, much, much worse than Tzlofchad. Go to the beach on Shabbat, go to a mall, shopping, working, all those things, much, much worse than Tzlofchad. We've had the Torah for 3,300 years. Much, much longer than Tzlofchad. We had much more Chachamim, teach us lessons, much more access. Much, much more than Tzlofchad. If Tzlofchad got the punishment like this, what are we getting? Chas v'chalila. So that's the one thing that people need to understand. Hashem is not kidding. This is the first violator of Shabbat. And that's what he got. Lastly, is the mitzvah of tzitzit. It's one of the tzitzit that you're probably going to remember. If you ever say to yourself, listen, I don't remember the Torah by heart. And everyone wants to know the Torah by heart. You know, we hear Meir every week. Yeah. Meir over here. Knows the entire Torah by heart. Yes. So this part, I bet you guys, you know it by heart. The last paragraph of this parasha, you know by heart. ויאמר אדוני משה לאמור דבר בני ישראל ואמרת עליהם ועשו להם ציצית על כנפי בגניהם לדורותיו ונתנו על ציצית לכנף פתית חלק והיה לכם ציצית. See, so you know this, but you know one part of the Torah by heart. But it tells you also this is the part of the Torah where we got the mitzvah of ציצית. So Hashem obviously started the parasha with the storyline, with the mistake and risk of using our logic, the consequence of using our logic and how far it can get us from the truth. Then he told us the punishment that is in the same level as those people that went against Hashem in the Midbar, that got 40 years. He's putting it in the same level as idol worship. He's also putting it in the same level as Mechalel Shabbat. But just like he started the parasha with a nice story, with the good expectations, with the gift we were supposed to get, he finished the parasha with the gift that we did get. We did end up getting Israel, but at least until then he gave us the mitzvah of tzitzit. The mitzvah of tzitzit is not only a gift that they got in that time, it's a gift that we still have today, it's an eternal gift. The Torah in Sefer Zachariah, it says in the Tanakh that every Jew that wears a tzitzit, in times of Mashiach, for each corner of the tzitzit, will have 700 slaves that will want to be slaves, will want to be, in essence, not the slaves that we think slaves like what happened in America a few hundred years ago. Slaves like the Torah slaves, like the Jewish slaves, where they wanted to be slaves. And in essence, students. For each corner of tzitzit, you'll have 700 slaves, or 2,800 slaves, just for wearing tzitzit throughout your life. This is in Sefer Zachariah, in Zachary. And the tzitzit is one of the things, one of the best mitzvahs that you can do because it's so easy. You get a mitzvah for each second. One of the sages during his, I think it was Aliyah Kadosh, before he died, a student saw him very, very upset. He said, Rabbeinu, why are you so upset? He says, because I'm leaving a world where for every second of Erein Tzitzit, I get a mitzvah. Where can I get a better deal than that? So us, we have to remember this. If he's upset, he's dying. He's going to Olam Haba. He's no tzaddik. He's upset about the mitzvahs that he's going to miss out on. Because they're so easy to do. So at least we should take advantage of it. And Bezalel Hashem, we will take advantage of it. Not only by doing tzitzit, but also by helping other people do the right thing. Keep Shabbat, keep mitzvot, learn Torah, and laat laat, do our job in this world.
Chazak baruch.